A very short answer.
Fun.
Crucial.
Lesson planning.
What's that? It's got to be done.
A restriction.
It needs to be flexible.
Thinking time.
Trying to sum it up as a quick response.
Keep things flexible. God.
This is planning.
Even if you don't stick to it, make sure that you plan your lesson really, really well.
Keep it short, concise, break it down.
Yeah, that's my evenings.
Bit of a straitjacket.
An integral part of the job.
And as you go along, it gets easier.
Don't spend ages on it.
I think the first 10 minutes of the lesson determine how the rest of the lesson is going to go.
I think what makes a very good starter is
maybe a quick video clip.
Something provocative.
Do you want to come in and do a little dance?
No,
didn't think you did.
It really depends on what the lesson is based on.
Beginning of lessons like the start of a film.
Something that's controversial.
How many eyeballs are there in the world?
That maybe challenges their values and views of the world.
Not quite sure what they mean by that.
Something that's very sort of...
Maybe posing a problem.
Cheers, geese.
A picture or an image or a question that will spark some sort of response initially.
That, and then how many swimming pools could you fill if you put all the eyeballs in together?
An aim, an objective.
Or a challenging picture.
I did a lesson recently on standard form.
And sometimes I'll put things on a projector and just put it up there and let them say, OK, well...
I had some pictures of deep space from the Hubble Space Telescope.
It might not seem that it has anything to do with the lesson at the very start.
And I just scrolled through about half a dozen of these slides.
But by the end, they see the connection.
Very much captured their imagination and allowed me an access into what might have been a much more dry lesson.
A really good starter is usually quite fun.
It might be a little game.
With drama, we often play games.
We've made Countdown.
You must have seen it on Channel 4.
We've made Boggle.
Countdown is a famous show.
All these sorts of games, you know, maths, English games, brings them in straight away.
So often trying to link the game to the activity.
You want a starter that's really going to captivate their interest, bring them in, make them think, right, I really want to listen to what's coming up next. I can't wait to hear the next bit for this.
Differentiation.
Depends on the students.
Various different ways.
The better you know a class, the better differentiation gets.
There's an element of trickery involved.
They tell you, I just deliver the milk here.
Planning it in is all about how well you know your group.
So the kids don't actually know that they've got a completely different worksheet from the person who's sitting next to them or the person who's sitting somewhere else.
One person might find this difficult, one person finds a lot of text difficult.
Often it's through questioning as well.
So why am I holding up these again for?
An element of choice.
Essentially, you plan three or four lessons in one.
I'd have a basic activity.
You'll have an activity for the students who maybe struggle with the main activity.
And who would not be able to access it? And that's how I embark on differentiation.
On the same worksheet or in the book, there might be, so if you feel comfortable with what I've just been talking about, if you understand it, then move on to that.
A lot of the time, I tend to use questioning as my main tool of differentiation.
I've got students that are gifted and talented. I'll get them to explain what I want them to do.
You have to see the group as individuals and not as an ability, because in a top group at the moment, we've got kids who are aiming for A stars, but we've also got some C's in there. So it's almost like teaching mixed ability.
How do you end lessons? Dramatically.
Sometimes it'll be discussion.
You start off with a conflict and you end with a conflict.
I'm going to be honest here and say that my endings of lessons are possibly something I should be working on.
A hot seating activity.
It might be a puzzle, it might be a past exam question.
The way the children respond to the lesson overall dictates how I end the lesson.
Similar in lots of ways to the start, to be honest.
Brings it all together, like the end of a film.
Yeah, I mean, what you want at the end of the lesson is for students to be able to articulate back to you what they have learned.
It's easy to fall into that trap of, let's summarise what we've done.
Sometimes I'm able to summarise the main points of the lessons.
The worst thing you can do is end a lesson on a negative with students saying, oh, that was rubbish, or I didn't like that.
Sometimes the students are able to summarise what they've learnt.
Questioning is always a good way to end a lesson.
Again, little games maybe, just to reinforce what we've been doing.
And sometimes it may be a little chaotic, to be honest.
Sometimes as well, I get them to line up at the door and I'll fire questions at them as they're leaving, so about the topic that they've done that day, and they're not allowed to leave until they get a question right.
And then at the end of the lesson, you send them away with another challenge that you then pick up later on in another lesson.
It really depends how the lesson has gone.
You know, blow their minds, hopefully. That's the idea.
And they leave the classroom thinking, wow, that was brilliant, I can't wait for next lesson, or if that lesson's going to be that good, next week's going to be amazing.
They should always be flexible.
They could be very flexible.
I've heard the term before.
Extremely flexible.
Oh, you gotta be. You gotta be.
I think they have to be, because you never know what is going to happen in the lesson.
If Ofsted are coming in to your school,
plan a lesson in terms of your timing, and that will never go according to plan.
It's probably very, very important to stick very closely to your lesson plan, because you know that it's safe.
I feel that sometimes lesson plans can be restrictive.
The key is to have an outline. So when you plan, you don't plan to stick by it rigidly.
And they might say, I have no idea what we're doing today, or I'm really unsure about what is going on.
I have to sometimes be able to throw the whole lesson plan away.
So I stopped what I was doing, I stopped delivering this A-level content, and I put up these pretty pictures. And I simply walked to the back of the class and said, well, what do we think of them?
They might totally change the direction that the lesson's going in for the better.
That then enthuse them back towards, well, hang on, maybe we can see a point of where we'd use this information, yeah.
I would have, in my mind, probably two or three pathways that I know I could then go on.
Flexibility, yes, that's where we were. Right, okay.
At first, when I started my training, I found that really difficult. I'd stand there with my lesson plan and think I need to rigidly stick to this.
Where the children take you is sometimes better than what you've planned anyway.
Plans are just that, they are just plans, and in life, things don't go according to plan. Yes, start of every lesson.
Say that again, sorry?
I normally write it up on the board.
At the beginning of the lesson.
Because we're told to.
Is the camera on? Is my head teacher in earshot?
Now, I was always told, as soon as the children walk in, have the lesson objective up on the board.
It's very, very dry if at the beginning of every lesson, students have to copy a learning objective down into their book.
It's nice to take a different approach, and sometimes the element of surprise with them.
My own approach is very often to create chaos and mystery at the start of the lesson, and then as the lesson develops and as the information emerges, the lesson objective will become clear.
Kids have got to know what the lesson is all about. Share the secret with them.
It's the idea of not leaving them in the dark.
And at the end, you can say, this was the objective, this is what hopefully you've learnt today.
It's important. They're coming in, they're going to spend an hour or so with your time. They want to know why. What's in it for them? What are they going to get out of it?
Progression.
Every day, really. You look at where you want to be, where you thought you'd be at this point.
With the bottom set year seven, you obviously aren't going to progress in a scheme of work as well as the top set would.
Telling the kids what they need to do to get to the next bit is really important. That's how you progress kids.
To me, back planning is the key. Put in what you need to get to first and work backwards. Hers has always stood me in good stead anyway.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, always. You can't help it. I think any normal person would.
I do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
I do reflect on the lessons, but...
The paper, I don't spend any time thinking about the piece of paper.
The way I reflect on my lesson plans is...
Beg pardon?
Maybe not almost in a written sense.
I could have done this better, I could have done this better.
At the end of lessons, most science...
If it went really well, or there was a section that didn't work, I would then adapt that for the next lesson, because I might teach the same lesson three or four times.
I spend a long time reflecting on my practice.
What worked well, what hasn't worked well for that particular group.
It's nothing I have to put down on paper and affirm it to myself and say, right, this has gone wrong, sir.
We might all sort of, this would be very impromptu. This wouldn't be something that would be planned.
I was about to make a very profound statement then. It was like the Gettysburg Address in here.
We'd kind of sit around, I suppose, and go through every single thing that went on in a particular lesson.
Early on, beginning teachers, or maybe within the first few years of their teaching experience, should be reflecting deeply about every aspect of their lesson, their planning.
Actually, when you step aside and step back from something and you talk it through with another teacher, you realise what actually went wrong in your lesson.
I don't have really, really rigid timings for, you know, I don't think you should say all starters can only last 5 minutes. I think if you've got a really good starter that's 10 minutes, then that's fine. I don't think you... It's to jump.
People like to hear, I have a starter, I have a main, I have a plenary. The objectives are shown at the beginning of the lesson, but it doesn't always work like that.
An average structure.
Beginning, middle, end.
The structure of the lesson is always start the lesson in exactly the same way.
I'd do the starter.
Then development, which is the main body of the lesson.
The main event, personally, I like it if the students are doing as much as possible rather than the teacher.
And you finish off with a nice, interesting plenary that brings everything together.
We all know about the three-part lesson, but I think it's been done to death.
I might scrap a plenary because the way in which the main part of the lesson is going is working really well for the pupils. If they need to be pushed on, we change the lesson structure.
You might have many starters, you might have several main tasks, you might have several plenaries. If it's a double lesson, you need to start thinking about how am I going to pace that out for two lessons? When are the breaks are going to come in?
I think what's coming in more and more is actually breaking the lesson down into far more pieces. The bigger the span that you have pupils trying to listen to something, the less likely they're going to concentrate for that span.
I think the three-part lesson, we overdo it. It must be like death by three-part lesson.
So it's how you break things up, how you chunk things together. You really need to think about that. Everything. Everything can go wrong.
In this job, anything can go wrong.
Everything. Everything's gone wrong.
Could go very wrong if you try and stick to it rigidly.
I think if you plan something and it's not working, but because it's a planned lesson, you stick to the plan.
That can go wrong.
Some of the biggest disasters I've had has been when we've just got started on a major activity and
the power goes off.
I'm hopeless at keeping to plans.
Fire alarm goes off.
Your types of questioning, your timings, your choice of activity.
Child could throw up all over the desk.
That's one thing I really learnt in my training, is that anything can happen.
We can, as teachers, I think, sometimes forget that actually we're teaching kids here.
It's the ones that fall apart, of course, that help inform your practice for the future. You think either I wouldn't do that again the same way, or I wouldn't do it at all.
Just go with it, don't panic over it, and just pull something out of the bag.
If I kind of let the kids go off on a tangent, I'm afraid it doesn't work, so I'm really bad at that. I have to be honest.
Everything that could go wrong does go wrong, and everything that could go right does go right. The skill, of course, is getting it right more often than getting it wrong. You'll have to ask the students if I do that. I don't know.